Hello and welcome to Strategic News International. I'm Surya Gangadharan. West Asia appears to be on a slow burn to war. The US has pulled out some of its aircraft carriers and is pushing them towards the Persian Gulf. Saudi Arabia has reported sabotage of some of its tankers in the Persian Gulf. And we also have reports of the Iran-allied Houthi rebels in Yemen using drones to attack a Saudi oil pipeline. We have with me Mr. Talmiz Ahmed. He was India's ambassador to Saudi Arabia. He'll give us some perspective on these developments. Sir, is it your impression that this region is heading towards war? What is your sense?
I don't think the region wants war. The provocations are entirely being engineered from Washington, D.C. There has been a steady escalation in this regard. There seems to be a desire to somehow provoke Iran into either withdrawing from the nuclear agreement or doing something provocative so that a limited military assault can be engineered by the Americans. So far, the Iranians have not obliged. I don't think there is a likelihood of conflict immediately. I don't think Donald Trump wants conflict. There is a deep divide in Washington in this regard. The most serious warmonger is, of course, John Bolton. This has been his dream plan for several years, and he now sees that he has a golden opportunity. Let's see how it pans out. There are war clouds on the horizon, but I personally feel it might not culminate in conflict just yet.
When you speak of limited wars, exactly what are you, what is your sense of what this limited war is about? Some strike somewhere on some Iranian installation? What is it that you're talking of?
I personally do not believe that there will be a limited conflict. If the Americans initiate an assault upon Iran, I'm absolutely certain that there will be a region-wide conflict. What the Americans are planning to do is in the first flush to take out a large quantum of Iranian assets on the ground so that its capacity for retaliation would be limited. Its game plan would be to retaliate along the eastern province and the oil facilities of Saudi Arabia, and the Americans would want to prevent that. But if there is any dream plan in Washington about a limited conflict, I'm not sure that's going to happen. There are various scenarios in this regard. Some people have argued that if there is a massive assault, as the Americans had engineered upon Iraq in 2003, conventional forces might get a serious setback, but then you will find prolonged assault upon the region from the Iranian side and from its various assets. So we are looking at not only a region-wide conflict, we are also looking at a very prolonged conflict.
What is the intention here? Is it regime change they're looking at? They want Iran to climb down from its positions in Syria on the nuclear issue. What is it?
No American commentator has been able to explain the US president's policies. There seems to be an absence of clear thought. There seems to be an absence of internal debate. And there is complete lack of clarity with regard to what the Americans really want in terms of their strategic advantage. Now, if the Americans want a better agreement with the Iranians and want to discuss various issues beyond the nuclear agreement, this is hardly the way to go forward. Even the meekest and mildest country in the world will not accept this kind of threatening conduct. And that is hardly the way to get them to the negotiating table, particularly when they themselves have not violated the nuclear agreement at all. So it is very difficult to understand what they want. Now, they say that the other game plan would be not a nuclear, an improved nuclear agreement, but a regime change. So this is the wet dream of American right wing for several decades. But it is, nobody takes this seriously. There was a massive assault upon Iran during the Iran-Iraq war. Chemical weapons were used. if passenger aircraft had been brought down, but you could not reverse the revolution. Indeed, you consolidated the revolution. So I am not sure what the Americans really want. My own view is that what the extreme right wing really is seeking is to put extraordinary pressure upon Iran, actually harm Iran and its people as an end in itself. I don't think there is any other strategic plan that they have in Washington, D.C. today.
So how stable is the Iranian regime? Do you believe that its economic situation is so desperate that it could, kind of collapse?
I know that their economic situation is difficult and has been difficult for many years. Their president has admitted this publicly in his last speech. But it is nowhere near collapse. The regime is extremely resilient. The country is very united around the leadership. There is no threat to the Islamic Revolution and its leaders. I do not believe that Iran is going to succumb to the pressures mounted upon them by these maniacs from Washington. I don't think that's going to work at all. That is hardly the way to go forward. You have to treat your partner with respect and then make it a matter of mutual advantage if you want to have a negotiation. This is hardly the way to go forward. I don't believe that we are going to see any collapse. We didn't see it earlier and we are not going to see it now.
So how would you explain Javad Zarif's visit to India? He'd earlier been to a couple of other countries in the region. What is he looking for? What support is he looking at? And did he get it in India?
Yeah. You see, what he was clearly looking at was to affirm the importance of the relationship between Iran and India. This is accepted by both sides. I think at the top leadership level in our country, the Prime Minister and the External Affairs Minister, both of them have asserted that they attach the highest importance to our relations with Iran. On that, there is no doubt. India has also been a very major importer of Iranian oil. I think what he would have wanted to discuss was to explain to the Indian side the Iranian perceptions relating to the pressures being heaped upon them. That would be the first point. He would also give the assessment with regard to the preparation for war that is being mounted upon them. Quite possibly, he would have sought an Indian advisory on Washington to suggest that you should cool down matters. It is not in the interest of the region for you to escalate the situation. I think there would have been a combined political, energy and economic package that he would have brought to bear. In the External Affairs Minister, he has a very friendly interlocutor. He is on record as saying some months ago that India only respects UN sanctions, making it very clear that these are US sanctions, these are unilateral sanctions, they are meant to subserve US interests, they do not serve the interests of other countries that have very substantial ties with Iran and indeed have no quarrel with that country at all. So we have to look out for our own interests. What the Indian side has said through the spokesperson that we will finally take a decision on the basis of our commercial interests, on the basis of our energy interests, and on the basis of our political interests. I think we've left it wide open. There is a suggestion in the media that a final view will be taken after the elections are done. But really speaking, I don't believe there will be a significant change. India will come up with various ways in which we can continue to purchase Iranian oil from the market, either as spot purchases or through rupee trade or through barter trade or any other mechanism that subserves our interests. We don't wish to provoke the Americans beyond the point. We have conveyed to them that their postures are wrong, that they are unilateral, they are not supported by any international norms or laws. But this is, you have a rogue administration in Washington today, and there is very little the international community can do about that. We have to safeguard our own interests.
So do you see India playing some kind of a mediatory role here, perhaps honest broker of some kind, passing on messages from Tehran to Washington? Do you see any of this sort happening?
I'm not sure that we are doing any such thing as of now. The country is consumed with the election process. It's a very difficult and lengthy process. It has polarized the country, and the rhetoric exchange has been extremely abusive on all sides. And the country really needs to recover from this process. We are going to continue even after the counting is done. Government formation is going to be extremely painful and extremely difficult. So we are in for a very prolonged period of uncertainty. Having said this, I think the United States does not need India to convey messages. I think the Europeans have conveyed messages very clearly. Pompeo visited Brussels recently and met the foreign ministers of 4 or 5 European countries. And the message is very clear that Europeans are not at all comfortable with what Washington has initiated in West Asia. They are concerned about the escalation of conflict, and they do not approve of what the Americans are doing, both with regard to sanctions as well as with regard to the escalation of military action.
What role do you see Israel playing in this?
Israel, as usual, is mischievous, but it is not seeking region-wide conflict. It does not see any advantage to itself. In Israel, I have found very often domestic issues overwhelm their entire rhetoric. And very often when their Prime Minister Netanyahu takes a certain position publicly, it is very often to subserve domestic interests. At the moment, he has won the election. He is in the process of forming the government, but he has very serious problems with regard to his personal integrity. And there is a case against him. He has succeeded in pushing the indictment, and he has delayed it further up to September, but he is going to face serious problems. And the Israeli media is already talking about a conflict between the executive and the Supreme Court. Now, this is in this background that Netanyahu has used some extreme rhetoric and has talked and has also conveyed to the Americans that the Iranians are up to escalation of conflict, which is completely bogus. They have done this in the past. They have tried it out today. But secondly, they are also leaking to the media various attempts that are likely to be made by them to attack Iran. I'm not sure any of this is likely to happen. Israel is itself exposed both from Lebanon and from Gaza. It has experienced a massive assault of missiles. At least some of them penetrated the Iron Dome and came in. I don't think Israel is looking for that kind of conflict, particularly when it serves no useful purpose. How is war in West Asia going to serve the interests of Washington, D.C. or of Tel Aviv? I don't see any advantage to them. I see serious disadvantage to them as well as to their allies in the Gulf region. So I think that if you are looking at Netanyahu's rhetoric, it is mostly connected with shoring up his image as a tough guy who is always looking out for the security of the Israelis. But the Israelis will see through this, and they know that this is a guy who is in serious trouble at all.
And what about Russia and China? Now, we had Russia intervening in Syria in a very decisive manner. Do you see Russia playing a similar kind of role vis-a-vis Iran? And then we also have the China factor there.
I think the situation in Iran and Syria is not the same. Russia is very clear that it is going to play a major role in world affairs. And it is going to establish itself as the arbiter of regional politics in West Asia. It has worked very closely with the Iranians in this regard through the Astana peace process. And I think there is a very strong degree of cooperation between Iran and Russia. I think that will continue. Russia does not favor US policies. Do recall that that Russia itself is at the receiving end of American sanctions. Mm-hmm. And while Russia has conveyed to the Americans that they would like to work with the Americans, the atmosphere in Washington is not advantageous, is not beneficial in this regard. So I think that what the American policies could do over the medium term is encourage these beleaguered countries, beleaguered by the American policies, China, Russia, and Iran, seeing advantage in cooperation between them. So what the Americans have actually succeeded in achieving is to put together a very powerful coalition in Eurasia. I think that some of the Europeans are likely to get dissatisfied with the approaches that they see from Washington, and they could join this coalition as well. So you could see the shaping over the medium term of a new world order directly as a result of policies initiated by the Trump administration.
Will this alliance that you see, will it mitigate Iran's economic situation?
Iran sees extraordinary advantage at a time of sanctions to build relations with both Russia and China. It would also like to include India in this company. And we do not as yet know what position we are going to take in this regard or how far we are willing to go. With regard to China, Iran already has very close economic and political ties. It also is a very major defense partner. Russia is also expanding its presence in Tehran, and I think that we are looking at very close relations between them as well. So, yes, if the three countries work together, some of the strain on Iran as a result of sanctions could get mitigated, certainly, particularly if India were to be in the picture as well. But this is an area of uncertainty. We do not know how far China would be willing to go to provoke the Americans. China has its own problems with the Americans with regard to trade, and I think that they will prioritize addressing those issues before they take on the Trump administration. But behind the scenes, I have no doubt that China is going to build ties with Iran, and that is going to be a very major strategic development in our region.
Sir, with reference to these attacks that the Saudis have reported on their oil tankers, are these, I don't know how credible these claims are. And does it also suggest that perhaps the Iranians are striking out, kind of telling the Saudis where they get off?
We do not have information about these attacks on the four tankers. The two countries concerned, Saudi Arabia and the UAE, have not given any information to us on the basis of inquiries they have conducted. What we have seen in the media is that the UAE has approached the United States to help with the investigation. We know that some very, very basic mines were attached to these and some minimal damage was done. There has been no loss of life. There has been no leakage of crude in the oceanic waters. There is every reason to doubt whether Iran would have been behind this. This is not the way Iran functions. This is a deliberately mischievous act of someone who wants to escalate tension in the region. The Iranians have blamed Israel, as certain other American writers have talked about this being done by the Saudis themselves. We do not know, and it is not appropriate to be pointing fingers. But I would doubt very seriously that Iran has been involved with this whatsoever. It is under a lot of pressure economically and militarily. It's not a foolish country. It does not act impulsively. It does not act provocatively. And I think that they would have no reason whatsoever to be initiating something so stupid which serves no useful purpose.
And these drone strikes that the Saudis have claimed on an oil pipeline somewhere in their desert, they say the Houthis did it. Now, this is really strange, isn't it? I mean, the Houthis are really non-state actors. And this would be perhaps the first time a non-state actor has used drones.
All of this is very mysterious. A climate of tension is being created, in fact, aggravated. You have the movement of military, the aircraft carrier and military personnel and aircraft moving into the Gulf. It has caused concern among many American observers, because this is what the Americans did when they were preparing to assault Iraq. So there is a parallel right there. Also, the other countries which would love to see an assault upon Iran are also possibly doing some mischief in the region to aggravate the situation. So about the drones, it all seems just too packed, that you have the movement of the aircraft carriers, then you have the attack, the so-called attack on the four vessels, which is very mysterious even today. We did no damage, but it aggravated the situation. And simultaneously, you have news of this so-called drone attack. All of this is coming together much too conveniently at this time. But they have, what they are banking on is the impulsiveness, the lack of application of the mind, and a very visible animosity that is there, that is animating certain sections of the U.S. establishment against Iran. And they are hoping that this is what they, that will finally be achieved. There was a point made some time back by an American that the Saudis would love to see that Saudis would love to see a war on Iran fought to the last American. And I think this is something that, which might be, the ground might be getting prepared for that, as they see it. I'm not particularly impressed by these developments. Certainly, I'm concerned about them. There is only one point that has come out from certain American writers, and that is that there is a deep divide between Bolton and Trump as far as West Asia is concerned. Bolton desperately wants war, and Trump desperately does not want war. So while he would be happy to participate in this kind of escalation, it is not acceptable. It's not clear that Trump would actually like to see a massive regional conflagration. He has been talking about pulling the few hundred soldiers they still have in Iraq and in Iran. Iraq and Syria, he wants them home, while the Bolton side is talking about deploying 120,000 American soldiers in the region. So I think there is a divide in the White House, and that may finally be the source of some balance, some stability, some sanity in the region.
So I suppose one can't rule out Bolton being eased out perhaps in the next couple of months.
One cannot rule out
Bolton being eased out of the White House, being eased out of his office a few months from now.
It's very difficult to say. As you know, Donald Trump's administration has seen a large number of people being thrown out of office from time to time. But as you have seen now, the two people who appear to have lasted are Pompeo and Bolton. In the assessment of most observers, Bolton would be ideologically close to the neocon group, and Pompeo, we well know, is a Christian evangelist. These are the two pillars of Trump's policy. They are the ones who have so far been the most influential upon him as far as West Asia is concerned. So they are the ones pushing for confrontation and conflict. Will Trump be able to hold his own against these two sources of pressure? That is a question that only he will be able to answer. There has been some writing in the American media that Bolton at some point, if he continues to escalate matters, might be shown the door. We do not know. His appointment itself has been completely surprising because he is known for his very strong anti-Iran posture for several years. His appointment was very surprising, but he has delivered what he had promised. He is hostile to Iran. He wants war with Iran. And if the president has to take the final call in this regard, we do not know which way he will go. Will he back his officials, or will he follow good sense? Now, we do not know. I think the jury is out on that.
Ambassador Talmiz, on that note, thank you so much for that analysis and perspective. Thank you, sir.
I wish you all the best.